Okay, let us begin. So what we discussed in our morning lecture, that the position of the wave packet is not completely localized. The wavelength of wave packet is also not unique. And this is what leads to what we call as uncertainty principle. A localized wave packet can be formed as a result of superposition of infinite ideal waves varying in their wavelengths. Wave packet travels with the group speed, which in the case of de Broglie wave is equal to the speed of the particle. This I have not shown it specifically, but it can be very easily shown that the group velocity of the particle waves actually turn out to be actually equal to the speed of the particle, which is important because if the wave has to travel, it has to travel with the velocity. If it has to represent the particle, it has to travel with the particle. So it must have same speed. Okay, now let's go a little bit more into the implication of the uncertainty, because this we feel probably is one of the most exciting and mysterious part of the entire quantum mechanics, which brings the idea of uncertainty probably a little more clearly. And probably one of the best book which deals with this particular thing is the Feynman's Lectures of Physics, Volume 3. So this is what I said: when wave nature and particle nature coexist, we have to allow certain tolerance in the way we look at nature. And how, that's what we are going to discuss today. Physical interpretation of wave, we shall discuss a little later. When we talk of a normal wave, electromagnetic wave, we know that what is varying is electric field or magnetic field. If you are talking of sound wave, now we know that these are particles which are traveling in the medium. Okay, when we are talking of wave associated with a particular, with any particle, what is moving, that's something which we have not talked about it. And then we'll talk about it a little later, because this is essentially fairly complex thing. But at the moment, just look at the implication of if wave particle duality exists, if a particular thing shows both wave character and particle character, how certain things which are commonly asked questions in classical physics, okay, become unanswerable when we talk in terms of the wave particle duality. So let's discuss about this particular aspect. So we'll discuss what is called famous Young's double slit experiment, which almost everyone knows in the high school, that there is a, when you have two slits and you have a monochromatic source of light. In fact, it can also be done with the water waves. Light is not really necessary. And the beam gets split. Okay, you have two slits, and then eventually they interfere, and what you see and your screen is the interference pattern. I make certain statements. Let's be clear that we agree with these statements. The experiments can be explained on the basis of wave nature of light. I think we'll all agree that, you know, this particular thing, interference, can be very easily explained in terms of the that two waves interfere with respect to each other. It's rather difficult to explain in terms of the particle nature. Wave nature is very, very clearly explainable. Now, I make this particular statement. See, at a point in the interference pattern where we see a large intensity, okay, in the wave nature, I would say that there has been a constructive interference. All right. But if I want to invoke particle picture, because we know that light also behaves like particles, I would say that a point where there is a maximum intensity, a larger number of photons arrive there at in a given time. Do you agree? Place where I see a dark fringe, okay, at that time hardly any photon arrives there. So this is a statement which I am making, and let us suppose, let's see whether we agree with this statement. In photon picture, a bright fringe would mean larger number of photons reaching that point, and a dark fringe would mean no photon reaching that particular point. See, remember, I am trying to mix the two ideas. So long I was talking about the wave nature, things were reasonably clean. When I want to mix, trying to talk of the two things together, let us see how this particular statement that I am making will land me into a problem. All right, but let's generally, I mean, everyone will agree, if you say there is a more intense light, the more number of photons, even photoelectric effect, that's what a more intense light means, more number of photons. So there is a source of light here. There are two slits, S1 and S2. There is one blue slit, another red slit. Okay. The wave comes, and there is what you see is basically on the interference pattern. This particular part at the moment, please ignore it. Okay, we'll talk about this particular part a little later. Okay, so this is what we are seeing in interference pattern. But this is not always uniform. There is also decays, all those things. Please ignore it. As I said, it's a very, very rough way of drawing. Just I want to bring to the point that there is an interference pattern. Now, we just now said in the morning that such type of experiment can also be done with electrons. Okay, in fact, I showed even a electron diffraction pattern. Of course, the length scales would be somewhat different, because when I am talking of electrons, the general wavelength that I'll be talking has to be much more smaller in comparison to, for example, photons I could have right from, you know, 10,000 angstrom to, you know, let's say 100 angstrom or 1 angstrom. We have varieties of photons, okay? While electrons, you know, one has to have certain limitations, but let's at least at the moment talk in terms of the thought experiment that let's assume such length scales are possible and I am able to do a similar experiment with electrons. So instead of light beam, okay, I have now electron beam. Okay, and let's assume that it's a monochromatic beam like a light beam, which is actually creating a monochromatic beam of electron. It's not all that problem. In electron diffraction experiments, you know, you have transmission electron microscope, scanning electron microscope, you always have a reasonably monochromatic beam of electrons. That's not a big issue. Okay, so let's agree that this experiment can be performed even using electrons. So let me just read. Let us assume that we perform this experiment with electrons by choosing appropriate length scales so that we can observe such an interference pattern. We know for sure that electrons can be diffracted like light waves. Now, we have no doubt about this particular thing that electrons cannot be diffracted. I mean, every day people do experiments to do electron diffraction. Okay. Now, I make a similar statement. When I see a bright fringe, okay, in electron diffraction experiment, like photons, I mean exactly the same thing. Similar to photons, a bright fringe would mean a larger number of electrons would reach. And when there is a dark fringe, it means hardly any electrons reach there. That's what it would mean, just taking parallel with the photons. Okay, exactly. When I see bright interference pattern, bright fringe, a large number of electrons have reached at that particular point. Okay, where I see a dark fringe, hardly any electron has reached there. Now, let me ask a question. These questions appear to be somewhat funny, but these are the questions which probably will come in every student's mind. How do the electrons reach the screen? See, remember this particular thing? Okay, here we are talking of photons, but you know, now assume that this source is not really a photon but of electron source. Okay, you are seeing a lot of electrons here. Okay, here you are seeing very large number of electrons coming, here you are seeing very few electrons coming, here you are seeing very large number of electrons coming, like that. Okay, my first question, which looks rather funny question, that how the electrons reach the screen? Obviously, electrons were emitted from the source. Probably there was a wall there in which these two slits were created. Okay, very large number of electrons got absorbed in that particular wall and they could not reach transfer to the other side. Let me go back to my, see, electron comes from here, hits this particular wall here, it is not able to go through. Electron comes, hits here, it's not able to go through. So if the electron has to go to the right hand side, it must have crossed either this particular slit or it must have crossed this particular slit. So electron must have gone either through slit 1 or slit 2 to reach to the other side. Do we all agree on this particular statement? So this is what I said. They are emitted from the source. Some of them move towards wall. Of course, some of them could be moving backwards. Okay. If they hit at a point where there is no slit, they get absorbed. Some electrons happen to arrive at a point where there is a slit and they cross over to the other side and then reach the screen. Are we sure? Let's do the experiment. Let's close both the slits. If you close both the slits, okay, no electron would reach on the screen. So we are sure that this statement is correct. Do you all agree? Okay. Close both the slits and we would not see any electrons on the screen. Hence, the presence of slit is necessary for the electrons to reach on the screen. Do we all agree on this statement? Okay. Very simple thing, probably very obvious thing. But now I'm asking some other questions which is going to land us into trouble. So let us look at these particular questions. Do electrons reaching screen pass through one of the two slits? Obviously, you are going to say that, you know, you are, I mean, in Hindi, there is a statement that, you know, you are taking skin out of the hair. I mean, what is this? This is obvious. This isn't this obvious because there are two holes. Okay, electron obviously has to pass from one of the slits. So this is probably looking a silly question. That's what I've written. Since the electron is a particle which cannot be split, so isn't it obvious that it should pass through one of the slits? How silly is the question? Okay, it's almost asking a question that all those who are in this room, they have come through this door or this door. Okay, if there are only, let's assume there are only two doors. Okay, obviously you have come either through this door or that door. You know, you could not suddenly appear here. Or you could not have passed simultaneously through both the doors and come here. Okay, there is always, you come either through door 1 or door 2, it's obvious. Had it been equally silly if you are talking about interference of two classical waves, if you are talking of two classical waves, let's talk about water waves. okay, if they are coming through the state, then probably this question was not all that serious. Okay, the wave, you know, you can always say that there is a wave which is simultaneously passing through that, and there is a new wave front created and all those things, you know, we know how to explain through the wave. Okay, if I would have asked this question, if I would have seen this interference pattern using a classical wave, probably this question would have appeared nonsense. This was probably, this question does not mean it, because then you expect the waves are coming simultaneously, they are getting passed through the two slits, and there they are interfering. Problem is our concept of electron as a localized particle. Let us see how. Well, it is not so silly as we have seen. As we have seen, if this statement is true, we can classify the electrons reaching on the screen into two types of electrons. Number one, those which have passed through slit 1. Number two, which have passed through the slit 2. Okay, so like we could classify people in this particular room. Okay, you have entered from this particular door, that particular person has entered from this door. So each particular person which is sitting in this room, okay, can be classified that whether that person has entered from door A or door B or door 1 or door 2. It's as simple as that. Okay, so it should be possible for us to do this particular type of thing, a type of naming the electrons. Okay, that once electron has reached on the other side, it must have come through slit 1 or through slit 2. Okay, then what, how to ensure that? Okay, let us suppose somebody objects, no, the person who is sitting in this particular room, okay, could not have come through this particular door. Okay, there's some other way that particular person could have appeared in this room. Okay, what we will do? Okay, we will ask them to repeat the question, you go all out. All right, then close one of the door and say you come exactly by the same way. Okay, close one of the doors. So those persons who were coming by one door, they'll get stopped because that door is no longer open. So only half the person, probably half or whatever it is, person will remain in the room which have come from the other door. That's what would happen. All right. Let us try to do the same experiment with electrons. Let me read through it because I don't want to miss any point. That's why I'm reading through this. Well, it is not so silly as we shall soon see. If the statement is true, we can classify the electrons reaching the screen into two parts. One, those who came through slit 1. Number two, those who came through slit 2. Can we experimentally verify this statement? This is what I want to verify. Now, perform the experiment. For that, we have performed three different experiments. The first experiment is that we keep only slit 1 open. Like that one I said, keep only one door open, close the other door. Okay. Choose a point P on the screen, which I have chosen earlier. Count the number of the electrons reaching there in a given time. All right. Keep on moving the position of your P, then you can plot how many number of electrons are reaching at a particular point. All right, so this is what I said. Keep on changing the position of point P and find N1. This is what I am calling is N1 as a function of the position for the same time. Let's suppose we choose, let's say 10 seconds, we'll count the total number of particles which are coming in 10 seconds. Okay, find out a different position if my particle is, let's go back. So this is my particle P. Okay, so initially I counted here, then I moved this particular point at different location, and then I start counting total number of electrons which are reaching that particular point in, let's say, 10 seconds, whatever time it is. All right, then do the same experiment, now close the slit 1 and do the experiment in slit 2. Repeat the same experiment with only slit S2 open, find N2 as a function of different position. And of course, third experiment is the same experiment when both the slits are open. Now let's look at this particular part of the screen. You know, when there is only one slit open, there is no interference pattern. Electrons cannot interfere. Okay, what at the best you will see a sort of small amount of diffraction. Okay, if a wave comes only through one single slit, there will be a small amount of diffraction. So your N1 as a function of X is likely to look something like this. Okay, but the width of this particular thing will be larger, smaller this width. It will be standard diffraction experiment. You know, there's nothing very important. If I perform N2, this N2 will also be exactly similar, slightly displaced with respect to S1 in the position, because this will be, this maximum will be closer to where slit S2 is there. Okay, so it's slightly displaced, but otherwise there will be similar position. But when both S1 and S2 are open, then what you start seeing something different here. Now it's very funny, because look at a particular point somewhere here, for example, or let's say somewhere here. When only slit 1 was open, you're getting very large number of particles here, electrons. Now, when slit 2 has started, we have also opened, suddenly the number of electrons reaching at that particular point has gone to 0. We just now agreed that electrons either have to go through slit S1 or go to slit S2. So did the electrons which are coming from S1 suddenly realize now slit S2 is open? So let us not go to that particular point but go somewhere else. All right? Doesn't it look strange for us to believe that electron, if at a point when the electron were reaching largely in number, initially when there was only one slit open, I have now suddenly opened slit 2 and suddenly at that particular point you find very few electrons reaching there. So if this statement is correct, our earlier statement that electrons are going through this slit or that particular slit, okay, opening this slit should not affect those electrons which are coming from slit S1. So at least those electrons should have reached that particular point which suddenly they have decided not to reach because of I do not know what reason. The answer is no. When one slit opens, one sees a diffraction pattern. There is no interference pattern due to the other slit. There are places on the screen which receive much less number of electrons when both the slits are open than when only one slit is open. Can electrostatic interaction change the path? You know, probably one can think, okay, maybe there is electrostatic interaction. After all, you know, when there was only one particular part, there is another beam which was coming and now probably there is some influence of charge influence and that's what is likely to affect. But the thing is that this experiment can be performed when electrons are coming so slowly that there is absolutely no chance for them to have an electrostatic interaction with any other electron. You will still see the interference pattern. And that's the video which I want to show you, which is actually the experiment which has been done. Okay, I'll show you it little later once we have discussed this particular aspect. Isn't it mysterious? Mystery. Even if electrons are emitted very slowly so that electrons reach one by one, still they would show interference pattern when both the slits are open. Do the electrons know that there is another slit open so that they decide to change their path? Yeah, this is one very, very interesting question which I always ask through the students. Are we equally surprised if we had used photon in place of electrons? See, with respect to light, we have been explaining interference pattern, diffraction pattern number of times. Okay, exactly the same statement would have been true for photon also. But if you ask student, photon has a, oh, after all, it's a wave. So, no, okay, it can behave like a particle. Electron? No, electron is a particle. Okay, you have problems when I say that electron is moving like that. Okay, then you get disturbed. But if we say photon, the same thing is true for photon also. See, photon has to either pass through slit 1 or through slit 2 and suddenly, you know, you suddenly find a very smaller number of photons. Okay, somehow have the photons decided that, you know, don't go through slit 2, go in a very small number to that particular point. Exactly the same statement which I have said is also true for photons. But if I describe that way for photons, no student will be interested. Oh, photon, wave. Okay, but when you describe with electron, people get shocked. Okay, how can electron? Electron is a particle, it's a localized entity. Okay, photon is a wave which is an extended entity. So, I mean, that's the picture we have, that's the classical picture we have in mind. And that's what is the picture which we want to sort of avoid or tell about that thing. Are we equally surprised if we had used photons instead of electrons? It's easier to imagine a wavefront hitting the slits, becoming source of wavefronts. All those things with photons, people will be very happy. But electrons, they are uneasy. So some statements which I am making, which personally I always like. So let me just read these statements. Our concept of particle is based on our observation of bigger particles. We can see them and we have never seen them diffracted. That's why we are surprised. Do you agree? See, whenever we think of electron, we always imagine this to be like a particle like this. Okay, this particle I have never seen diffracted. Because the wavelengths are so small, you'll never get it diffracted. Okay, so therefore, I mean, I don't expect, I mean, electrons also to get diffracted. We do not know how the particles appear when it is as small as a fundamental particle. Clearly, we do not see these particles the way we see bigger particles. We never see electron. Okay, so we don't know how electrons really behave the way we can see a particle like this. It's a mysterious particle. Our impression of a smaller particle is based on the extrapolation of our ideas of bigger particles. That's what we thought. After all, if you make it very, very, very tiny, after all, it should look exactly identical, except it has become tinier. All right, that's the way we think. So we extrapolate that, you know, if we keep on reducing the size to very small, that's the way particles should behave. Okay, these extrapolations clearly are not correct. The particles does behave mysteriously when it's small. It does behave in a very, very funny fashion. Now, one can, I mean, this is again a thought experiment, as Feynman says, that can we observe the particles? Okay, it's not very easy to observe electrons in that sense, but you know, just imagine that's the reason it's called thought experiment. Put a source of light there so that whenever there's a particular particle which comes, okay, you can really see whether particle is going through slit 1 or slit 2. Put a source of light here, okay, just before your normal screen. So, I mean, like if I have to see whether a person, you are coming from this door or from that door, what I will do, I put a source of light. Okay, when you are entering here, the light gets reflected and then I see that you are coming. Okay, so let's imagine that I could do the same thing for electrons. Okay, I put an electron beam of light there and then you find that electrons, when electrons are coming, a flash comes and then I know that the electron really is passing through that particular particle. And if at the same time I see a counter there on the particular screen, then we know that this particular particle has actually come from this particle. I mean, the one which you just now observed is the one which has reached the screen. You can imagine such an experiment. Yes.
In case of electron, what about the coherence?
See, like you can talk about any wave nature, you can also talk about the coherence of this particular wave. So the fact is that, you know, electron waves in that sense are no way different from any other classical, I mean, for that matter, electromagnetic waves. So you can talk about coherence exactly in the same fashion. But my idea at this particular moment is not to talk about coherence and what condition you can observe interference. Okay, you have to create coherent beam in order to get interference pattern. In fact, you also divide the beams exactly in the same fashion as you do in the case of optics to see interference pattern. My idea is that suppose we have observed interference pattern, my idea is to bring out the mystery or the uncertainty which we are actually landing ourselves into. Okay, in order to protect wave particle duality. See, either so long we talk only about wave nature, we have no problem. So long I want to talk only about wave particle nature, I don't have any problem. Okay, when you have an experiment which basically shows a wave property and there you want to introduce particle property, that's where you have problem. That's where you are supposed to be answering these questions, okay, which we do not know how to answer. And fortunately for us, there is uncertainty principle which actually envelops all those things. You can say it's uncertainty. If I want to do an experiment, I will never be able to find it out. That's what basically the uncertainty principle is. Okay, so we say put a light source. If you put a light source, you'll always find that electrons indeed pass through either slit 1 or slit 2. Nothing else is happening. But in that case, when you will open both the slits, you will never see the interference pattern.
You mean you have put in the path of light. And you are writing that
put a light source to watch the
that's precisely what I am coming to that. See, thing is that, why interference pattern is lost? Because you realize that when you are putting light source, you are perturbing the experiment. Because this particular light source consists actually also of photons. Okay, and we know that photons and electrons can interact. We just now discussed about the Compton effect. So when a photon comes and hits an electron, this is likely to deviate the path. When it's likely to deviate the path, I am not getting interference pattern. So can't I reduce number of photons? If I reduce number of photons, there will be a time when I will not be able to see any electrons. And only those electrons will be able to show the interference pattern. You can also say that, okay, what I will do in order that perturbation that is created by these photons to watch these electrons is very large, I will use a very, very low energy photon. If I use a very, very low energy photon, it means I am using a very large lambda photon. Okay? Then still you will be perturbing the experiment until a situation comes when your lambda is so large that your resolving power has become so bad that you will never be able to know whether the flashlight has come, it has come from this particular slit or that particular slit. Because after all, resolving power depends on the wavelength. Basically, the question is that whatever experiments you do, you will never be able to do this particular. In fact, that's what Feynman writes very clearly, that that's what's uncertainty principle. You will never be able to perform an experiment where you are sure that particles pass through slit 1 and slit 2 and also retain your interference pattern. It's not possible. If you are, I mean, of course, this particular experiment can be explained on the basis of uncertainty principle, which probably I'll not be able to do it, but we shall indeed find that the electrons pass through one of the two slits, but now interference pattern would be lost. The photon interaction with the electrons could have changed their path. We can reduce the perturbation by using low energy photons. If wavelength increases beyond a limit, the resolving power would be reduced and the two slits may appear as a one broad slit. Only in such circumstances, we will be able to get back the interference pattern. This statement I would like to mention because this is very, very important, because many times when we teach a certain principle, the way it's basically introduced, sometimes students have confusion. Uncertainty principle is fundamental. Perturbing the experiment while performing measurement is known also in classical physics. I mean, many times people always give this example, which personally I do not like. For example, if you want to make a current, measure a current in the circuit, okay, you have to add an ammeter. When you are adding an ammeter, that itself is going to perturb the experiment, because this particular ammeter will have always a small resistance, and therefore the current in the circuit would change. Suppose you want to measure the voltage between the two points, you have to add a voltmeter, and this voltmeter will also draw some current. When you draw some current, the voltage will change. Okay, so whenever you are measuring something, you are always perturbing the experiment. Okay, people take this particular example and say that this is uncertainty. I personally do not like this particular thing, because the thing is that in normal standard thing, we always believe that if we have better and better precision, you can keep on measuring things to more and more accuracies. Okay, here when we are not talking of two coupled things. Uncertainty principle is a fundamental quantity. We can make still a statement that if I have to measure the position of a particular particle, I can keep on measuring if I have better and better equipments. Okay, I may have a normal ruler which can only measure plus minus 1 millimeter, but I can go to better and better resolution, I can have better and better apparatus and measure as closely the position as we want. In that sense, we are agreeing. But as and when we try to measure positions very, very clearly, I will make momentum measurement more and more uncertain. These are two coupled things. It's very, very different from just perturbation of the experiment. Okay, I can measure position as precisely as I want. Okay, but in that case, I will make momentum more and more uncertain. Similarly, momentum, if I want to measure momentum, if that's my focus, I can measure momentum as precisely as I want. But in that case, I will make position more and more uncertain. So here we have two coupled things. So in that way, it's very different from just the perturbing the experiment. All right, you have two coupled quantities. If you measure one of them more accurately, second one goes off. If you want to measure this more accurately, other one goes off. Okay? In that sense, it's different. So let's go ahead, where I essentially try to use this particular thing to calculate the order of uncertainty principle, just to convince the student that this uncertainty product is very small in comparison to H, is of the order of H. And I always refer to a very well-known book. I think, you know, this is a very nice book. I'm not sure whether you are aware of that thing. It's a book by George Gamow, Mr. Tompkins in the Wonderland. I'm not sure whether you have heard this particular book. It's a very, very beautiful book. Okay, this book, I think, have been recently republished, and it's just called Mr. Tompkins, I think, if I'm not sure. The name has been slightly changed, and it's by George Gamow. So the book is actually a funny description of modern physics, and it's like a student who is going through a course on modern physics, and then in the night he dreams and he goes to a different world, and there are various type of worlds. In one world, where he finds the velocity of light to be of 20 miles per hour. So that person starts seeing relativistic effect in daily life. So he finds that, you know, as he's driving very, very fast, the market is contracting and things like that. All those very, very beautifully described the entire effect. There is also an effect on the uncertainty principle. It's called quantum jungle. See, a person reaches to a particular point where Planck's constant happens to be very large. It's of the order of 1 joule second. So, you know, then he starts seeing uncertainty principle everywhere. He goes to the jungle and there is a lion which is coming, and he does not, because the uncertainty is so large, so he does not know whether the lion is coming from this side or is coming from that particular side. It's a very beautiful description of the book. You know, if some of the students, or if, for that matter, even some of you are interested, you know, it's worth reading. There is a different approach which I normally like to do also. It's a single slit diffraction experiment. So let me just try to tell a little bit about this particular approach of evaluating the order of uncertainty product using this particular experiment. So let us assume that we perform now a single slit experiment. Consider a single slit diffraction of a beam of monoenergetic particles, and we try to interpret this on the basis of both wave and particles and try to get an idea of uncertainty principles, because uncertainty principle is the one which, as I said, protects the two. Therefore, whenever you try to mix up these two ideas, you have to invoke about the uncertainty. So let us assume that there is a source of particle. Let's assume that this source of particles is very, very far off, almost at infinity. If it is at infinity, the beam of particles which is coming will be essentially parallel along the x direction. They will all be moving along the x direction, and they will be essentially parallel. So it means Vy, or that way, for that matter, y component of the momentum would be zero. We are very, very sure, because this particular source has been kept very, very far off. Do you agree? If that happens, my uncertainty principle tells that position along the y direction would become very, very uncertain. It means I'm not sure where my particle is going to land up along the y direction. So this particular particle may come here, this particular particle may come here, this particle may go there, may come here, which also is understandable because you have put your source so far off. Okay, so a particle may land up on this particular thing anywhere. So it's perfectly all right that this particular uncertainty principle is valid. Now suddenly this particular beam of particle meets with a slit, which is here, the width of which is d. All right. Now once it enters through this thing, suddenly the uncertainty in the position y component of this particular beam becomes finite, because only those particles which pass through this particular slit will be able to pass to the other side of the particular screen. All right. Now suddenly the uncertainty in y component position by position becomes finite. Now my uncertainty principle says that it means my uncertainty in the y component of the momentum will also no longer remain zero, it will also become finite. All right. It means these particles who are actually coming straight may suddenly not come straight, may decide to change their path and they may develop a y component of the momentum. That's what is diffraction. All right. Now you can always argue it out. This is one thing which again I try to illustrate, that once I find a particle, let's assume that this particle is electron, I mean it can be done for any other particle. If this particular particle reaches here, I can find very precisely what should have been the y component of the momentum, okay, for this particular particle to reach here. But what uncertainty principle talks is about predictability. When it was passing through the slit, was I sure that this particular particle is going to pick up a particular component of momentum? Okay, uncertainty principle talks about that particular thing. So when it picks up the component of the y component, this particular particle could go straight, may turn upwards, may turn downwards, it may turn anywhere. Okay, this predictability cannot be there. Classical mechanics always talk about predictability. In classical mechanics, if I know force, if I know the position, if I know the initial conditions, I know the final condition precisely. Okay, but this is what is something different when we are talking of quantum mechanics, or for that matter wave particle duality, that you are not very sure when the particle is passing through the slit, you are not very sure whether it's going to go this way, whether it's going to go this way, whether it's going to go straight, what angle it will make, what y component of momentum it will pick up, that you are not very sure. That's what this particular uncertainty principle talks about it. Of course, this is the angular position where we see the minimum will be given by d sin theta is equal to n lambda. This is a well-known diffraction experiment. The smaller is the slit width, the larger will be the width of the central maximum, that we know about it. The experiment can be understood by the wave theory. Now let us bring the particle nature, assuming that the experiment is being performed with particles. Assume that the source is in finite distance away, therefore electron move in y direction. Delta Py is equal to 0, therefore delta y is equal to infinity. That's what we just now discussed. Hence, we are not sure of the y position of the particle at all. What happens when the particle passes through the slit? Delta y is suddenly made finite. Hence, delta Py can also not be 0 anymore. Hence, the particles would pick up a y component of the momentum in a totally unpredictable and uncontrolled manner. Smaller is this slit width, larger is the uncertainty in the momentum component. It's consistent with what we expect. Yeah.
If I say it is totally unpredictable, totally uncontrolled,
then it gives a miss, kind of creates a confusion. Uncertainty principle gives a measurement of uncertainty. How much will it? As we know delta y, so we have an estimate of delta p y.
That's right.
So how can it be become totally unpredictable?
See, that's what it means. See, when we're saying delta p y, in fact, you can define it using standard deviation, you know, all those things. See, quantum mechanics is always about unpredictability. You can always say that there is a finite, how much is the probability of finding particle here?
Yes.
We always talk in terms of probability. We are never talking about surety. So see, the basic difference in the classical mechanics is that if I know that this particular particle was here at x is equal to 0, okay, and this is the force, then I will know at time t is equal to 0, at time t is equal to 1 second, where this particle will be exactly located. Now, what I am trying to say that I know the same conditions, but I am not very sure whether my particle will be here or my particle will be here. Okay, it's represented by a wave function, and that describes what is the probability that the particle will be found here, what is the probability that the particle will be found here, what is the probability will be found here. The probabilities are predictable, but not the position of the particle. So that's what I'm trying to say. What I'm talking is the position of the particle, the momentum that it picks up. Okay, this whatever you are going to get the width, that is predictable. The width that you are going to get is predictable. Okay, but if I am talking of an individual electron or individual particle, what value of py is going to get, that is unpredictable. Like in a wave function, it's unpredictable whether this particular electron which has gone through this particular force will be exactly found at. Okay, that's not predictable. It could be here, it could be here, it could be here. Probability is predictable. Okay, similarly here, what is the width it's going to get? That is predictable. In fact, that's given by d sin theta is equal to n lambda. All right, but what is not predictable for an individual particle? When classical mechanics for all individual particles, since we are predictable, a particle goes this particular way, it's going to land up here, nothing else. It cannot do any other thing. I mean, this particular thing is best described in a step potential. A particle comes with a particular energy, okay? In a classical mechanics, if this potential energy is larger, all the particle has to be reflected back. If it is smaller, all the particles have to go, okay? Well, in quantum mechanics, there is a possibility that some particles also get reflected back. But which particle will get reflected back, you don't know, okay? There is a probability, certain number of particles are going to go back, okay? But which particle is going to go back, that I do not know. I cannot predict. Once it has gone back, then I can say, oh, I know this particle has gone back. All right? But I cannot say that it is this particular particle before it has traced its path, that this particular particle is going to go straight or is going to come back. That's something which we cannot say. In that sense, this is unpredictable and uncontrolled. Smaller is the slit width, larger is the uncertainty in the momentum concept. Can't we find out the momentum after an electron reaches the screen? That we can do, but that's what the uncertainty principle does not talk about. Of course, you always saw Newton's law. Okay, Newton's law, of course, you know, we always have equivalence of Newton's law, but this applies only on the averages, as probably you are all aware. This is actually the way we define uncertainty, which is standard deviation. As you know, the averages are generally written by the angular brackets, and there are various type of absolute uncertainty minimum. You can show that it's going to be only for a Gaussian wave packet, which happens to be like h cross by 2, which you get in harmonic oscillators. And there are various type of uncertainty principle. There is also a time energy uncertainty principles. So these are the various uncertainty principles that happen.
So what is the difference between minimum uncertainty and uncertainty principle?
Well, see, uncertainty principle, uncertainty problem, let's say, as I say, at the moment, whatever we have talked about uncertainty principle is only very, very qualitatively. We have never talked about quantitatively. We just say it should be happening. It's to make, again, the lectures a little more glamorous, a little more attractive for the students to pick it up. Okay, but all these uncertainties can be actually defined. And this is what I have said, that this is the way to define uncertainty. Okay, it means, for example, if I have to define the uncertainty in position, so you see what is the mean position what is the mean value of the position. So that's what I'm calling G under angular bracket. Okay. So the thing is that this particular uncertainty is defined in this particular fashion, and you can get a quantitative information about the uncertainty principle. Okay. Now, this product, if you take delta x, delta px, standard deviation in x and standard deviation in momentum, and take the product of these two, this particular product will depend on what type of wave packet that you are talking about it, or what is the wave function of the particle. Okay. Now, this product may be much larger than h cross by 2, depending on what type of wave packet that you are talking about it. What you can show mathematically is that absolute minimum is h cross by 2. And that happens only for one type of wave packet, which is the Gaussian wave packet. Okay, which happens, for example, in the harmonic oscillator in the ground state. Okay, that's actually the Gaussian wave packet. The wave function actually is a Gaussian, and that's where you get delta x, delta px greater than equal to h cross. That's the absolute uncertainty product minimum. But if you go to any other wave packet, in fact, for the particle in a box, we do derive, and probably I will not be able to do particle box, but at least I will give you those particular expressions. You can actually use this particular expressions and find out what will be the uncertainty product, for example, for a particle in a box wave function, which will be much larger than h cross by 2. All right? Yeah.
What is physical interpretation of uncertainty in time?
Uncertainty in time. Well, the way it's interpreted, of course, generally time and energy uncertainties are measured in a slightly different, okay, let me give it in a slightly different fashion. See, like the way at least I have introduced uncertainty principle is that saying that because everything is limited in position, and therefore if a wave packet is limited in position, okay, therefore delta x delta px has to have certain values. That's the way I have introduced it. Now you can also talk of exactly same thing in time domain. See, a particular wave packet also has to be limited in time. It cannot be limited for infinite time. A particular wave packet cannot exist for infinite time. Okay, there is only a certain finite amount of time where this particular wave packet will exist. And because like in the expression of wave, you have kx, you have omega t. Okay, if it is finite in t, this will create a finite amount of, you know, uncertainty in omega. So if I want to limit this particular wave packet not in the real space but in the time domain, okay, exactly the similar type of arguments will take place, the one which I have taken in the momentum and the position domain. So either I can make it infinite in time, that I can measure omega exceedingly precisely, okay, or if I have to limit in time, my wave packet is you know, my pulse is for a very short duration, okay, then delta t becomes very small, then the spread of omega will be much larger. Exactly the same arguments which I have used in terms of position, replace position by time. See, wave, I mean, remember, wave can always be represented for a given time as a function of x, okay, or for a given value of x as a function of time. Okay, so all I am saying that whatever I have, all the graphs that I have put as a function of x, replace them by time. You will get in a time energy uncertainty principle. But the physical meaning of the time uncertainty principle generally often comes in what we call as the emissions. Okay, because if, for example, there is an excited state of an atom and which leads to an emission of a photon, okay, you know that there is only a finite lifetime for which this particular state can exist in an excited state. And then either it will be stimulated emission or there will be a spontaneous emission. When there is an emission of the photon, okay, this particular photon in the time domain cannot have a larger time domain than the time at which the atom has remained in the excited state. Okay, therefore, there will be spread in its energy by that particular amount. So delta E, delta T will become of the order of H cross. So it means the beam that you are going to come out can never be monoenergetic because you have not given infinite time for the wave packet to develop. Because this wave packet which has come out as a result of transition had only a finite amount of time to get developed. So this will be limited in time. And therefore, by the same thing, because I am going to make a wave packet in time domain, therefore its energy, its omegas will get spread out. All right. Therefore, you will never be able to make this particular beam perfectly monochromatic. There will always be a small spread in energy. Okay. So, in fact, that's what comes. There is always a natural line width for any source. Okay. And that depends on the total amount of time at which this particular atom or nucleus, depends on what type of transition you are talking, okay, remains in the excited state. So, you can never make a beam 100% monochromatic just because it will avoid uncertainty principle. That is only possible if it had an infinite time for this particular wave packet to develop. Okay, it will never have infinite time, it will always have finite time. Therefore, there will always be small amount of width in any beam as far as the monochromaticity is concerned. Any other questions? Yeah.
Any detailed research paper is regarding that particular?
That I am not very sure. So, I'm not very sure that they have published it. I'm not, but I mean, it requires a little bit of more of study, which I have not done it.
Thank you, sir.
So, if you are interested, please go through this thing. Maybe they have done it. I think the experiment was done by Tonomura. If you do a Google search on Tonomura, maybe you can see whether he has published this particular paper or some other paper, you know, from Hitachi. So, it's possible to see it. I mean, if you want to really work on this particular thing, it should be possible to do it. But I have not done it. Now, let's come to the Schrodinger equation. Now, we look for a new law and try to see what should be the new form of the law which can be used for something which is neither a particle nor a wave, okay, or in between or both, the way you want to put it. All right. Now, we had two classical equations. First equation, I am sure all of you know. I am pretty sure you also know the second equation. The first equation is Newton's law of motion, which is force is equal to mass into acceleration. Second is the standard wave equation. Okay, this wave equation, you know, even when you are doing electromagnetic wave, you can derive this particular equation. In fact, that's the way you derive it. And I mean, for any ordinary general non-standard wave, this particular equation is used, generally called wave equation. Okay, now thing is that whether one of these equations will be adequate to describe something which is both particle and a wave, which is the equation that governs a non-relativistic. Of course, let's be very clear that when we are talking of Schrodinger equation, it's non-relativistic. Particle with observable wave behavior. The first one does not even imply a wave nature, so we'll ignore the first one. Let's examine the second one, which actually is a wave equation. Let's see what are the problems and what are the advantages. These are various waves, ways in which a wave can be represented. All of you agree, okay, sin kx, cos kx, okay. Some of you had said that cos kx is better than that or whatever it is. And many times we use imaginary numbers, When we use imaginary numbers, we can also use A e raised power I k x minus omega t or e raised power minus I k x minus omega t. Remember, I have written all those waves which propagate in plus x direction. See, today morning we discussed how to define whether it's moving, how to find out whether wave moves in the plus x direction or minus x direction, because it depends on the sign, relative sign of x term and t term, because the two signs are different here. There is a kx which is plus kx and there is a minus omega t. So all these waves represent, they have a motion in the plus x direction. Now, first of all, you must convince yourself that all these four waves satisfy the wave equation, okay, which is very, very simple. All you have to do is to put this particular thing into that particular equation, which I am doing in next 2-3 transparencies, which I will avoid here, because I mean this is for our first year students, where I want to tell them, you know, convince them that, you know, this particular thing is actually satisfied by this thing. So let's take, in fact, I take one of these particular things and one of these exponential terms and say that whether you use any one, any of the four, this will satisfy the wave equation which I have just now written. So you take psi, then you take d psi x, d psi dx, then you take d2 psi dx square, then you take d2 psi dt square, then you can see that the equation gets satisfied and c square turns out to be equal to omega square by k square, which is the phase velocity, which we have already discussed. You can take an exponential term, it becomes all the more simple, because sine and cosine term, there is a problem that once you differentiate, sine becomes cosine, and when you differentiate second time, then only it becomes sine, okay? While in this case, there is no problem because exponential always remains exponential. All right, so you can see that this also satisfies the wave equation with the same c is equal to omega by k. Now, the second thing which I want to insist, which is probably very, very important, is the superposition of wave. This particular wave equation allows this particular fact that two waves can superpose. It means if there is a particular wave which is given by psi 1, another wave which is by psi 2, this particular thing can superimpose. See, it means they are also a solution of the equation. If this equation is actually a valid equation which describes the wave motion, and if superposition is not allowed by these waves, then we can say that superposition will not be possible. Okay, but we know that the traditional waves do superimpose. They ought to be solution of this equation, and that I want to convince the students that they actually become the solution of this equation. We know that electromagnetic waves, even of different wavelengths, superimpose. All we know, I mean, we have done in the morning Beats experiment, we talk about Beats experiment, their wavelengths are different, they superimpose on each other. If we say that wave equation is the wave governing the electromagnetic wave, it implies that superposition should also be allowed by the wave equation. It means if A sine kx is a solution, sine kx minus omega t is a solution, then A sine k prime x, if I add to this A sine k prime x plus omega prime t, that should also be solution of this equation. If that does not happen to be that solution, and if this equation is a true equation which governs them, then that particular superposition will not be possible at all. Okay, this wave will go like this, this wave will go like this, they will never interfere. So if psi 1 and psi 2 are solutions of the wave equation, psi 1 plus psi 2 also has to be solution of the wave equation, which next thing I will show. In fact, it can be even generalized, A psi 1 plus B psi 2 will also be solution of this equation. Okay, so let us verify, as this is the key to interference, formation of wave packet, because everywhere we are interfering. Even wave packet, we are saying that, you know, you have infinite number of waves which are interfering with each other. Okay, so this I give a typical example, that suppose there are two different psi's, which one satisfied this equation, another with this equation, okay, then we take the solution, we add these two, okay, this equation can be written in this particular fashion, psi 1 plus psi 2, so psi 1 plus psi 2 is also a solution, provided c is same, for light c is same, okay, therefore, this equation can superpose. We see that psi 1 plus psi 2 is also a solution of the equation, but note that c has to be same for both the equations. Now, if this particular wave has to describe particles, that's where we are going to land up into the problem. A particle, for example, can travel with any speed, all right? That restriction that wave has to travel with c is only for electromagnetic waves, okay? If you are talking of a particle, okay, particle can travel with any speed. So, if I have c is different for the two equations, they will not superpose. That's what's one of the problem. So, in fact, the wavelength of particle depends on the speed. That's what we have said. The wavelengths and the speeds are interdependent. If we take two particle waves corresponding to the same type of particles, for example, electrons, with different wavelengths, they would not superimpose if the standard equation was governing it. That's what it comes to it. But we have seen interference of electrons. We have experimentally seen it. I know that electrons can interfere. Therefore, this particular wave cannot describe the motion of those particles which have wave characteristic. All right? Because we are now looking for a wave equation. So can we form a wave packet? We probably need another equation. That's what I'm going to say. This is where we have to look into one interesting aspect. If the constant appearing in the wave equation was not dependent on dynamical properties like speed, momentum, energy, the superposition could have been valid. Remember this equation, what was the problematic thing? Is this C which is coming here, this C which is coming there, you know, this particular thing. Okay, these things can add only when C is same. If you go here and this one C1 and C2, then superposition will not be possible. Okay, this is the situation which we are landing up when we are talking of particle, because there is one V1 and there is another V2. Okay, therefore superposition does not become possible. Now this constant which was appearing here, this particular constant, whatever is this constant, if somehow we can make it that this does not depend on dynamical properties like momentum or energy or speed or something like that, okay, if it is possible, then superposition becomes possible. So let us try to look for an equation in which this particular constant, which is, see, what is this constant? This constant is relating the position, derivative with respect to position and derivative with respect to time. This constant is relating derivative, first derivative, second derivative, whatever it is, but derivative of wave function or of the wave, okay, with respect to position and trying to relate to derivative with respect to time. So this constant, which relates the two, if it is independent of the dynamical properties, then it's possible that superposition will be valid. So let us look, how is it possible to make this constant independent of the dynamical properties? If the constant appearing in the wave equation was not dependent on dynamical properties like speed, momentum or energy, the superposition could have been valid. Now, we know of this equation in the non-relativistic case. Kinetic energy is equal to p squared by 2m for a free particle where there is no force. So, there is no potential energy involved. Okay. So, let's talk of only a free particle under the influence of, without the influence of any force. So it obeys this particular relationship, kinetic energy is equal to p squared by 2m. All right. Now we have a wave equation which is of the form e raised to power or sine kx minus omega t. There is x term which is related to k. Okay, there is a t term which is related to omega. All right. Now if I differentiate with respect to x, okay, I will get k out. Okay, if I have sine kx minus omega t, if I take partial derivative with respect to x, it will be k times this thing. You agree? If I take derivative with respect to time, omega will come out, omega times psi. Do you agree? Now you also realize that in the case of particles, k, which is dependent on wavelength, depends on momentum. All right? Omega, h cross omega, is supposed to depend on the energy. All right. Now, the equation that we have under our control is k is equal to p squared by 2m. Now, suppose we would have taken derivative, which was in the following way. I take derivative with respect to x twice, partial derivatives. Derivatives are partial derivatives. d2x, d2 psi, dx square. So, I will get k square times psi. Agreed? K square is related to momentum, h cross k is supposed to be momentum. But try to relate it to first derivative with respect to time. Delta psi, del psi, del t. When I take derivative, only omega will come out because I have taken only one derivative. Derivative once. So on left hand side, you have k square. On right hand side, we have omega. This omega can be related to energy. K square can be related to momentum. And because we have this equation, p square by 2m is equal to k, this thing will cancel out. So probably the equation which I should think about is something which relates to the second derivative in position and tries to relate it to the first time derivative. Then probably it will work, and then the constant that I am getting may turn out to be independent of dynamical variables, and therefore probably I may land up, I mean, remember, we are in dark, we are not deriving Schrodinger equation, we are not deriving, nobody can derive Schrodinger equation, we are just putting in arguments. Like Lorentz transformation, we did not derive, you know, we put certain arguments. So we are in dark, we do not know where to go. So we are trying to find our way. All right. So why not try something like this? Why not try an equation, something like del 2 psi del x square is equal to gamma del psi del t. then maybe this particular gamma would not depend on velocity, may not depend on momentum, may not depend on energy. Therefore, particles with different type of velocities can superimpose. Therefore, I may be able to generate my wave packet, I may be able to have interference pattern. Is this point clear? All right, but there is one big problem. If I am taking psi as A sin kx minus omega t or A cos kx minus omega t, once I take derivative twice with respect to x, first time sin becomes cos, second time cos becomes sin. Okay, well, I am taking first derivative with respect to time, okay, sin will become cos, it will never become sin again. So on left hand side you will have sin term, right hand side you will have cos term, that psi will not cancel at all. So A sin kx minus omega t or A cos kx minus omega t will not be a solution of this equation at all. All right. But instead of that, if I take an exponential term, A e raised power I kx minus omega t, that doesn't have this problem. Because if you take, either you take derivative twice with respect to x or you take derivative once with respect to time, okay, it will only have exponential term. That can cancel out. Therefore, if we are looking for this equation, if this is a correct equation, then my psi has to be always complex. Okay, it can only be represented in the form of A e raised power I kx minus omega t. That's what makes wave function very, very mysterious. It's basically a complex quantity. But are the standard displacement equation given by pure trigonometric equation a solution of it? Traditionally, we take the solution into this particular form. This is what I have said. It's a simple differentiation. You take differentiation twice with respect to x, this term will cancel it out. Okay? Put into that particular equation, the trial equation that we have done, you will be able to get the value of gamma. All right? As we have seen, that gamma just depends on fundamental constant h cross and also, of course, depends on mass of the particle. But that's okay because I have never seen electron beam diffracting with a or interfering with a neutron beam. Always the particle of the same type interfere. Okay, either we have electron beam interfering or only neutron beam interfering. Okay, I have never seen that one particular electron beam is coming and neutron beam coming and they interfere with each other. All right, so let mass be there, I don't care. All right, so I have solved my problem. I have landed up into an equation with this particular value of gamma, which probably would work. Going back to our old equation, I put this equation here, this particular thing, and eventually land up at this particular equation. Put the value of gamma. In fact, this is the way this equation is put. The reason we'll discuss later, probably you already know, in terms of operator, we define this particular quantity. Therefore, this equation is written in this particular form, which is the equation which we expect, if whatever our argument, our thinking process is correct, that this is the equation which should represent a free particle. There is only one thing which I would like to sort of point your attention to this. While coming to this equation, I have taken this wave equation always in this particular form. When we will come out and take what we call as a time-independent Schrodinger equation, this is generally called time-dependent Schrodinger equation, okay, then the time term will go away. But we must remember that in all these derivations of Schrodinger equation, the time-dependent term was always taken to be of the form A e raised power minus I omega t. Then only we can describe in which direction the particle is moving. Otherwise, I will not be able to describe that particular thing. Physics would not have changed if I would have taken any other way. I could have taken in a different form. I could have taken this term as positive. The sign of gamma would change. But this is one of the very common problems that we give to our students. What would have been the Schrodinger equation if instead of e raised power I kx minus omega t, I would have taken e raised power minus I kx minus omega t. The time dependent term would have been positive. Nothing of physics will change. None of the interpretation, nothing will change. Okay? But we take a convention, and the convention which has been taken is to take the time-dependent term negative. The only one thing which I would like to mention, because we have also done a course on relativity just now, that here this particular energy, you know, whenever we are using in this particular thing energy, is meant to mean the classical energy, because the same E I have used for E is equal to mc square, which is the total relativistic energy. So one should not get confused, because in Schrodinger equation also we use E. So let us be clear that, you know, this particular E that we are talking is going to be somewhat different. If you have any questions, then please, you know.
In the experiment that you have shown, was the source of this electron coherent or incoherent?
Well, this is only one electron.
Does that matter?
It doesn't matter because the electron is actually coming only one by one. So, I mean, it's hardly able to form a wave in that sense.
Yeah, no, actually what I was thinking of, because if you look into this experiment, Actually, it looks like that there is an inherent time scale for watching that pattern. I mean, it's not that you can, because finally, you need to observe it for a certain amount of time or more than that to really observe it. So if you are not really observing it within that time limit or more than that time, you cannot see that. So your interpretation of the experimental result will depend on the time scale of what you are actually looking at. Mm-hmm. So what I was thinking is that it's somehow, if you look into in totality of this experiment, somehow an electron which has already crossed that slit and hit the screen, or and the electrons which are supposed to go through that, all of them somehow know each other, that where they have either ended up or somehow where they have to end up, so that finally over that time scale, after that time scale, they should actually create that pattern. So that is not somewhat looks in possible if they are completely incoherent. If they don't have that information, then it looks like if a motion of an electron is completely random of the motion compared to the motion of the other electron, then I don't expect, I mean, that's a kind of natural expectation that I cannot expect that pattern to be seen.
See, that's what that particular experiment says, and in fact, that's the statement which is made very, very clearly, that this particular beam has been so slow that the probability of finding even one electron is so low that normally you will not even find one electron. Okay? Now, chances of finding two electrons was anyway very, very small. So it's really coming one by one. So you can imagine that this particular electron has gone and reached the slit, and by that time the second electron has not even started.
What I was thinking is that instead of sending the second electron from the same source, if we use a different source.
That I do not know whether they have tried.
Does that look a valid question?
I mean, it's a definitely valid question, in the sense that, when the quantum mechanics was being developed, people always thought, there was a lot of possibilities which were being discussed.
Yeah, so.
And one of the possibility was that, are the particles intelligent?
Yeah.
Can the particles think? Okay, can the particles really know that, as we say that, of course, most of these interpretations are now not accepted.
Yes.
Okay, if you look at many of those things, the history of this thing, development of quantum mechanics is fairly interesting.
And yes,
the type,
yes.
Of exactly. Arguments which you are giving are fairly interesting arguments. But at least that's what's not believed now.
No, I was trying to think of that, about the time scale. Is there some relation between the time scale and the...
I don't know.
The interpretation of that time scale?
I don't think so. At least that's what they claim, that, we are so slow that chances of having any information exchange is not possible. That's what.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions?
I have a question in a double slit experiment, sir.
Yeah.
We know that electrons behave like they have wave nature.
Yeah.
In the double slit experiment, when we carry out the double slit experiment, then we should expect the diffraction, right?
Yeah.
But here.
No. In double slit, there is interference.
Yeah, interference. Yeah,
so that's what we expect interference. That's what we got. Until you perturb the experiment. See, so long the electrons are coming one by one and you are not really disturbing them, they will form interference pattern. That's what this happens. And if the electrons pass only through one of the slits, then they will form diffraction pattern.
So, does it happen because of the wave nature of the particle?
Precisely. That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
I think this has been too heavy, so let's just stop.